This solar eclipse in Aries kicks off the entire 1.5 year cycle of eclipses in Aries and Libra. And it's the second new moon in Aries technically, given that solar eclipses are new moons. So with having two new moons in Aries technically, we have a whole lot of Aries energy going on here. It's really exciting. I like this eclipse, but also caution around eclipses. Putting that all together, this is what to expect for this eclipse in Aries. This is what it means for your sign and what we can all prepare for along the way. So if you're excited to dive into what we can expect from this solar eclipse in Aries, actually total solar eclipse, mind me, make sure that you like, subscribe, and hit that notification bell so you are always up to date with what the stars have in store for you. Firstly, we're gonna get into the overall vibe of this total solar eclipse. Then I will get into what exactly to expect for you for this eclipse. And if you're wondering what happened to my world predictions, etc., I'm finding it more useful to predict those in specific videos rather than tag them onto these general readings because it gets a little monotonous and a little windy. If you have not already seen your April forecast for your rising sign, you should watch that as well because I make entire videos for each sign each month that describe how this is showing up in your life as well as everything else going on in April. And if you want to check out my courses or my daily horoscopes, I have exclusive content including those things on passes linked down below. All my daily horoscopes and my courses are there, as well as you can check out my exclusive one-on-one readings down below if you want a private reading with me looking at your chart. This total solar eclipse in Aries is happening on April 19th, 2023 at 9:13 p.m. Pacific time. So technically it's a little bit after midnight on April 20th Eastern time. Most people in the world, this will be April 20th for you if you're on Pacific time or a different time zone that also corresponds with that, then it will be on April 19th, so 19/20th. This is a total solar eclipse, and solar eclipses are always new moons where the sun and the moon are together at the exact same point in the sky. And this is taking place at 29 degrees and 50 minutes of Aries, literally just like in few minutes before Taurus season starts. So at 29 degrees, 50 minutes, which is the specific, like it's not time minutes, but minutes is the specific, like there's degrees and then there's minutes in the degrees. 29 degrees, 50 minutes of Aries is the telltale end of Aries. And this is in the third decan or the third of Aries. Now all of Aries is ruled by Mars, but this third decan has a bit of Venus rulership, which adds a charismatic, celebratory, empowering energy. It's not fully or exclusively Martian, which is very dedicated and very assertive. This Venusian energy, which is also associated with the Four of Wands tarot card, is about appreciating how far you've come or putting on a show, having a celebration for what you have gotten so far. Now, the positive side of this part of the zodiac and this card is that it is very celebratory and very fun. It is not an overtly challenging part of the zodiac. But the downside can be that we're celebrating too early and being too proud of ourselves with not enough accomplished to warrant that level of a break. So all in all, to summarize off the bat, this is a total solar eclipse, so a huge new beginning that is celebrating how far we've come. However, solar eclipses are always new beginnings, so we should be careful to embrace that new beginning and not stop because we're proud of what we've already done. So we've achieved something, we've achieved a goal, now we need to level up and use that as a foundation, not a resting place. So to go back and talk about eclipses, eclipses are the pivotal world events for the year. And generally when we think about what has happened in a year, a lot of the defining memorable events took place around eclipses. They mark the catalyst for society and world in that year. And they're generally not going to be subtle. They're generally going to be particularly pivotal. Solar eclipses, which are new moons versus lunar eclipses, which are full moons. Solar eclipses are the new beginning side versus the lunar eclipse is the ending side. And with the gravity of an eclipse, this is a catalyst new beginning. It's not simply one other chapter in a book. It's a new moon on steroids. And in ancient times, solar eclipses were omens for the downfall of kings when they were usurped by a new ruler. So often we can symbolize this today with a new ruler coming into that area of our life. New inspiration, new guidance, new impetus of our own action. It is rarely like a literal king nowadays that's getting usurped. Like, no, it's now in our particular lives. There is a new foundation, a new impetus, a new inspiration in that area of our life, but it inherently comes off of destruction or a clean slate being wiped. It is not simply a gradual or easy new beginning. It's generally like a volcano erupting, and from that we're rebuilding. However, it is not inherently challenging, as if this were a Saturn or Mars transit where there's literally like, bitch, you're gonna hurt. This is more like, okay, so something has been destroyed. However, I was not necessarily harmed with that, but the life circumstances have changed and I now have a catalyst for a new beginning. And with the solar eclipse in Aries, Aries is a cardinal fire sign. It is the rebel, or not the rebel, as much as like it is the 100 meter dash. It is the fastest, the first, the most linear, the most simple, the most direct. I would say the rebel is more Sagittarius. However, Aries is the determined first person. It is extremely immediate. It is impulsive. It is courageous. It is simple. If there's a simple sign, it is Aries. It does what it wants and it gets there quickly. So it often has themes of the self. Not because Aries equals self, but because if we're having characteristics of linear, simple energy, that reflects us. It's not bringing in complications. And what is the simplest thing in our life? It is us. So this is about doing what is right for you. Realizing that there's been a foundational shift around your self-interest in one area of your life, and you're now kicking the ball. You're getting the ball rolling and kicking it off in a way that is a new indication of what's best for you. So you're probably very excited about how far you've come in this area of your life. I will talk about which area of life this is for you at the end of the video, and you can also watch your April rising sign forecast. But you're excited about how far you've come in this area of your life, and you're using that for motivation for the next level. You're suddenly realizing, wow, I achieved that. I now have motivation based on myself as my role model to achieve the next level of things. So look back, pat on the back, wow, keep going. You're not at the top of the mountain yet. So this is within 5 degrees of the North Node. And what an eclipse is astronomically is when the sun and the moon are either together or 180 degrees apart on the ecliptic, which is the sun's orbit. So with the sun and the moon pretty close to the North Node, the northern part of the ecliptic, it is technically a total solar eclipse. The North Node is still technically in Taurus, but it's at the very end. So that's how it can be a solar eclipse in Aries, even if the North Node is in Taurus. So it's still out of sign, but it is very close. So it's still total, and it's conjunct Jupiter within 6 degrees. A conjunction is when planets or points are very close to one another in the sky, and within 6 degrees is pretty close to Jupiter. Jupiter is the planet of exuberance, of abundance, and of growth. This is why I am more optimistic than usual or pleased about this solar eclipse, even if I don't recommend starting anything, which I will also explain a little bit. So it's adding that this is a positive time, it's a positive new beginning, even if it's coming off of the heels of a destruction. Now, it's close to Chiron in Aries, but it's not super close. So Chiron is an asteroid that represents vulnerability, healing, and taking our greatest shame into our greatest lesson that we provide others. It's a transformation of going from humiliation into helping others with this. So it's not really close to this new moon, to the solar eclipse. So I'm not seeing this being a particularly emotional solar eclipse. I don't see it being that heartwarming, you could say, or like really deep. However, Chiron will be squaring Mars in Cancer. And since squares are aspects of tension and of conflict, a square from Chiron to Mars shows that we are likely easily aggravated and particularly sensitive or triggered. I don't think this is going to be deep, because it's not close to the solar eclipse itself. But with Mars and Cancer already being particularly like petty or sensitive, I think the square to Chiron shows that we are like as soft and sensitive as a fruit being thrown around. I'm getting the image of like a bruised peach. Like, we are very sensitive around what's happening. This does not mean that what is happening is bad, just that our egos are easily bruised in regards to what this new beginning is. And Venus will be in Gemini, squaring Saturn in Pisces within 3 degrees, which is an engagement, or is the most intense aspect that we can have. It's the most relevant. So Venus values squaring Saturn blockages shows that there's some type of inhibition on relationships and a boundary around love or appreciation for others. And this may be a detail around feeling that we have to embark on this new beginning in our life alone because there's something that is restricting others from helping us and having that work out. So the new beginning is positive, and yet there's also some type of boundary with relationships where we feel like we gotta do it alone. I can't trust anyone. I don't wanna be around people. There's some type of blockage that is preventing you from appreciating others. And there's a dually independent quality because Aries is already independent. Venus square Saturn is like, let's get serious. I need to do this alone. This also emphasizes that there could be a lack of money or resources provided. If you're looking for others for help, they may not be offering that. Mercury will be conjunct Uranus and Taurus within 2 degrees, which is extremely close. Mercury is communication and Uranus is chaos and disruption. This shows radical, disruptive communication. However, with this in Taurus, Taurus is not wordy. It is very specific and it is very deliberate with what it says. So look for people to be very firm in announcing some crazy shit they're working on during this time. Personally, they're probably going to be making the world very aware of their BS. Like, they're going to be like, everyone needs to know this. They're going to be very firm, very succinct. And Mercury Uranus on the plus side can be very innovative and very genius. So look for some important technological achievements that are announced, but it's not low-key and it's not nuanced. So people who have something to say are going to say it very boldly and very firmly. However, they're not going to be overly wordy about it. Mercury in Taurus is not overly wordy or it does not go on and on. Because the solar eclipse is at 29 degrees of Aries, the very end, almost in Taurus, it is squaring Pluto at 0 degrees of Aquarius. If you look at the chart, you will see it's nearly a 90 degree angle. So even though it's out of sign, it is still technically squaring Pluto, which shows uncomfortable transformation or the need to level up and become more authentic and have a part of ourselves die and be reborn. Because it's out of sign, I am not seeing this as the most relevant detail, but it is in there with this new fresh start. So it's overall a very empowering, very fresh new beginning in a particular area of life for you. However, with eclipses, I always recommend waiting until after eclipse season to intentionally manifest or work with this energy. Why I say this is because eclipses, well, technically why I say it, I have a full fucking video on it. You can look up eclipses, Marin Allman. I talk about the nodes and why I don't like to work with them. And nearly every astrologer, unless they're trying to pull some funny, rebellious, like I'm so different, BS is gonna agree because it's pretty understood that eclipses are basically like, if you're trying to work with an eclipse, let's say, it's like trying to light a match under a wildfire. Yeah, you're gonna do it, but the destruction and the overall involvement that you'll have is not really what you want. So eclipses are huge catalysts that are far greater than you. And if you wanna try to use it, be my guest, I don't care. I'm not like super, I don't care, like do what you want. However, you will likely find that there's a huge amount of complication or getting in over your head with themes that you were not prepared for with what you wanted. It is the quintessential be careful what you wish for. And if you look at the people who were born under solar eclipses, you will get a good taste for the type of personality that a person has who was born under this, which is like a lot. I was born under an eclipse. I was born about a day after. And I mean, I wouldn't wish for anything different, but like, it's insane. My life is insane. I don't even know where to begin. You guys on social media see like 1%, like maybe. And you think my life is crazy, but there's stuff that like, it's not even that I don't share, it's that it involves other people and I am not very private, but other people I understand are private. So eclipse energy is, I don't wanna say it's inherently chaotic because Uranus is chaotic, but I would say eclipses are insane. And with an eclipse on the North Node represents ambition, increase, volume up, and more. It is like more insatiability. So even if you achieve something or start something under this new moon, this solar eclipse, it's never gonna be enough. And you might be like, oh my God, I get to the top and I have nothing. So I'm not trying to scare you. Bitch, people say I'm fear mongering just because I'm not love and light. Like, this is your time, bitch. It might not be your time. It might not be your time for a decade. But with eclipses, I recommend seeing how they show up in your life. And then after eclipse season, continuing on with that work. So look and wait to see how this is showing up in your life and then proceed with any developments that you want after eclipse season ends, which would be May 6th onward, because there is a lunar eclipse May 5th and eclipses come in pairs. So 2 weeks after this one, the lunar eclipse happens May 5th. Then you're smooth sailing basically May 6th. I mean, I wouldn't literally do it May 6th because like, damn, that's fast. But I mean, I'd be like second half of May. Like wait about a month, 3 weeks to a month. Because then you will feel like there's more grounding in this development. And be my guest, like start whatever you need to on this day. In fact, like don't be too anal about it because you have to like wake up, you're gonna make coffee, you're gonna go to the grocery store, you're gonna do something this day. Don't be scared shitless around like, oh, I can't do anything. I need to be catatonic. Do what you need to do. I just wouldn't like literally sign the most important document, launch your company. Ideally, like have your metaphorical baby. I wouldn't have it this day. I would do it after eclipse season starts. But I mean, do whatever the hell you want. Sometimes I start stuff under eclipses just to be like, universe, fuck me over more. But I would say if you're launching a project or anything important, wait until after May 5th. Easiest thing I can say. But I would look forward to this eclipse because even if it's uncomfortable or sudden, it does show a positive, empowering new start in a particular area of your life. So if you already have thoughts around how this is showing up or what you were expecting or hoping for with this solar eclipse, make sure to comment down below. I would be interested to hear from you about it. Now I'm going to run through what it means for your sign and what to expect. As I just said, I don't recommend starting anything intentionally under this. I would recommend chilling, waiting, seeing how it shows up in your life, and then proceeding with any active work after May 5th when eclipse season finishes. But starting with Aries, this will be in your first house of self. And even though the whole first half of this year has been like time for Aries placements, if you're in Aries rising, so this is by rising sign, this only applies by rising sign. This will not apply. I don't give a fuck if it resonates. I don't care if it resonates. Anyone can say anything resonates with anything. It doesn't mean shit. This only applies to your rising sign because I have full videos on why you need to be reading horoscopes for your rising sign that you can also look up. I will link all that down below. Sorry, tangent. Anyway, Aries rising. This is huge for you. First house of self, huge breakthrough, huge catalyst, huge like I am becoming this person. No, nothing can stop me. My identity, my personality, it needs to skyrocket. Develop. That's what that is. If you're a Taurus rising, this will be in your 12th house of mental health, addictions, afflictions, and spirituality. So you're likely going to have a positive breakthrough where you're like, I'm no longer coping in that way. I'm no longer going to let myself have this addiction. I am no longer keeping this internal. I need help. I want to reach outside myself to catalyze that change. If you're a Gemini rising, this is in your 11th house of networking and friends. So you may feel the urge to network or connect with a group of people that accelerates your life and in particular your professional career. If you are a Cancer rising, this is in your 10th house of career. So pretty simple, huge catalyst, huge empowerment, huge up-leveling that will be starting to be realized in your professional life. If you are a Leo rising, this will be in your 9th house of foreign travel, higher education, or belief systems. So you could be either starting a study abroad, you're accepted into a program, etc. You could be accepted into a school or a trip program, either or. You could also be planning a major trip or move abroad, or you could be having a breakthrough with your religion or philosophy to believe something different. If you're a Virgo rising, this will be in your 8th house of shared finances, investments, loans, and loss. This is probably going to be for most of you around investments, taxes, or loans with starting something new. So you might be taking out a large loan, you could be buying a property, you could be inheriting assets, something complicated financially. It is not your income or your spending. It is something complicated financially. For a very small amount of you, this could be that something happens as the result of a death in your life. This will not be the death itself, but it could be that some shocking news or some new assets or like rights come your way because of a death in your family. For 99% of people, it's just gonna be like, I took out a loan and that changed my life, or I got a new credit card and that was important. For a very small percent of people, it could be death related. However, with the 8th house, it's not really going to show that there was a death directly, like insane trauma. It's gonna show more of like, there was a death, so you had to deal with the morgue and the casket and the funeral, things like that. Like you have to deal with the things of death. If you are a Libra rising, this will be in your 7th house of committed relationships and partnerships. So this is a huge new catalyst. I'm very excited. I'm just tired, so I'm not expressing it that well. But this is very exciting for your relationships because it shows that a particular serious relationship is being catalyzed and brought to the next level. This is not inherently romantic, although for most of you, the most plausible thing would be marriage or committing to someone long-term. If you're not and have no possibility of that occurring in your life, it shows a business partnership or a best friend that is becoming as relevant as something in marriage. It's contractual, it's important. If you are a Scorpio rising, this is happening in your 6th house of physical health issues, coworkers, or pets. So you may either be starting a new treatment plan, a new diet and exercise routine because you're addressing something you want to change, or you could be hiring a new staff, getting a new round of coworkers that really changes your life, or you could be getting a new pet or starting something very important with your pet that is particularly huge. If you are a Sagittarius rising, this will be in your fifth house of dating, romance, and kids. So there could be a huge new romantic relationship that kicks off. It could be very important for you. It could be just like a whirlwind. It could also be a creative project that's taking off. You could have something new creatively coming your way. If you're not someone that has any possibility of a romantic relationship, then it's likely going to be the creative side of things. And it could also be kids. So if you're trying to get pregnant, this is a really good sign for Sagittarius risings. If you're not, then it likely does not mean that you're suddenly getting pregnant. Like, I mean, I would be surprised. But it could show that there's a kid in your life that's really important. If you are a Capricorn rising, this will be in our fourth house of family and property. So there's a huge new beginning happening around your living situation or with your family. If you're moving somewhere, this could show that you're grounded and the home is like finally, you know, becoming your home. If it's around family, it could show that you are having a major change in your family for a new beginning. If you are an Aquarius rising, this is happening in your third house of day-to-day routine, content, and information. So if you're enrolled in a course, it could show that you're starting that. Could also show that you are beginning a new writing project or a new form of content that you're kicking off. Third house is short form content, short form information, and also our day-to-day routine of intaking that. But likely, it's probably going to show that it's a new way of creating content rather than like you download a new app and that changes your life. Like it's more going to be around, I think, the creation and the communication rather than the intake in this case. Then if you are a Pisces rising, this is happening in your second house of income and finances. So second house is your direct income and spending. It is not investments, loans, or taxes. So you're likely either selling something new, kicking off a new income stream, you've gotten a new side hustle or job, or you're spending money in a new way that is very empowering and very important to you. But probably due to the empowerment factor, it's going to be you making money in a new way or kicking off a new income stream. So I'm finally going to pull a card from the I Ching, which I just got like this weekend. And this is the second video I'm using it in because I filmed the Libra full moon video today because I batch film. So like, I don't give a shit if people know that I'm filming a bunch of them a day, like why not? And I just spilled cards everywhere, but I randomly kept two in my hand. So we're gonna go with that. Since I spilled all of these everywhere, we're gonna go with the two that are in my hand. 1 and 64, whoa, that's I literally like the deck spilled, I'll show it in a second, or I don't really care. Like the deck spilled on the ground, but I still had two in my hand. I have 1 and I have 64. So we will start with 1. This is so cool that 1 came up for an Aries solar eclipse, like the most 1 first thing. This says, the receptive. There is no weakness associated with this card. It represents pure and integrated creative power, bringing into movement all things in the universe and human life. A time under this sign is full of inspiration and energy, leading to inner growth and worldly success. Use the fortune of destiny with intelligence and farsightedness. Ensure that your actions also serve to bring good fortune, happiness, and prosperity to your fellow human beings. Don't waste your creative powers on unplanned activities. Sometimes it is even better to do nothing at all. Now you can achieve even your highest goals. You need to organize your powers, behave honestly, and keep stable. The more trust you have in your own powers, the stronger you will become. That seems like a fucking relevant message for this. Like, stick to the course. And then we have 64, which is this the final card? I think it might have worked out that way because like I grabbed the deck and it happened. So this is 64. Before fulfillment. This sign can be compared to springtime, which leads to the fertile summer after tempering cold of winter. It is a time as difficult as it is beautiful. Harmony reigns, life flourishes, and prospers only after its completion. You need to draw upon all your strength to cope with a task of this nature. It will be presumptuous to expect a sudden solution to all the problems with just one roll of the dice. The ground is still shaking under you. You must carefully create a foundation enabling you to bear the load. You are heading for an all-encompassing renewal of life. This departure for new shores is accompanied by anxious expectation and new hope. So that is so synchronistic that those two cards together would have come out because that describes this solar eclipse. Like a super empowering new start where you're like, oh my God, I'm doing it. But it's coming from, oh my God, like it's, I'm thinking of like a meme I've seen where you see someone that climbs a hill and they're like, I made it. And then they get to the bottom of the hill and they see that there's a huge mountain. And it's like, you did the hill, now you have the mountain. And it's very exciting and I would say chill, see what life offers to you, and then get excited for whatever shows up and goes your way. So I wish you an incredible Aries total solar eclipse. Now looking at this deck and how beautiful it is, I've never used the I Ching and it called out to me in the store the other day. And like, this is so beautiful. So I like that we have this now. Take care. Let me know how you're feeling down below. Like, subscribe if you have not already. Check out my private readings and my courses and shit if you want. And yeah, I'll see you in the next one. Oh, there is one.